Hello,
I'm Daniel McKeon.
I'm David Estes.
We attend Searsport District High School and we work on the SMART project at the Hutchison Center in Belfast.
So, our question was, how would the removal of Mill Dam affect the health of Mill Stream and would fish be able to survive in the creek? Now, we take this question into context by analyzing all the fluctuations of the stream quality with rainwater. Our hypothesis, without the dam, fish will be able to swim upstream and spawn in the waters of Keynes Pond and McClure Pond. There will be no harms to the aquatic ecosystem they would enter.
According to the USGS, Keynes Pond supports a population of American eels, and that's a catadromous organism. This means they move from salt water to spawn in fresh water. So years ago, when the dam wasn't in place, a population of American eels moved up the stream, giving us a reason to believe that this event would occur again if it was possible, meaning if the dam was removed.
Now, Mill Stream, its headwaters are located near Keynes and McClure Pond. The stream is approximately 4 miles long, leading into Penobscot Bay, which you see here. And we tested three sites leading from downstream to upstream. We tested site 3, 2, and 1. And there's a dam just south of Route 1, which is right here, which is just south of that. And it is near a nearby restaurant. It has been in existence for over a century. And a physical evaluation was done at each site according to the methodology of the book Testing the Waters.
From here on out in the presentation, site 3 will be referred to as the upstream site. Site 2 will be referred to as Mill Pond, and Site 1 will be referred to as Downstream. Although some of the graphs contain two charts for a downstream site, a downstream and below dam, and that's because we have to change access points halfway through the year.
Now, here's Site 1. Site 1 is located approximately 260 feet downstream of the dam, and this picture right here is showing our site as well as downstream, and the dam is actually right upstream from our site, which is right there. And it's accessed from the backyard of 17 Steamboat Avenue, which is located on the site, is a large conifer with plenty of clear open space where our data was collected. The stream is covered by a mild underbrush, which in the pictures is slightly seen right here. Above the site, there's conifer trees which cover 75 to 100% of the stream. And for site 2, our site is located right upstream from a dam, and upstream from this site is strictly wooded land, which is seen in this picture here. It's accessed from the NAMI Art Gallery Museum right off of Route 1, which is also displayed in this picture. This is Route 1, and here's our site. And site 2 is very marshy throughout the year, with over 75% algae growth and cloudy water particles. The river bottom consists of about 95 organic debris. And the river banks consist mostly of grasses, around 70%, and some shrubs, about 25%. And the opposite bank is mostly shrubs, around 90% shrubs, and only about 10% grasses. There are also a few conifer trees located on the banks, giving Site 2 a 25 to 50% overhead canopy. For Site 3, it is located about 25 feet off of Old County Road, and right here we have Old County Road, and the stream runs under the road through two culverts, which is also seen in this picture here, and then flows downstream to Site 2. Now, this site is a very forested, remote section of land with 50 to 75% overhead canopy. One bank has a variety of 45 shrubs and 30% softwood trees, and on the other, there's a bank with about 50% shrubs, 25% softwood, and 25% hardwood trees. Site 3 is also very biologically active, 50 to 75% algae growth on the stream bed. And the stream bed is mostly rubble and sand, which is 50 to 75% embeddedness of rocks.
So this is our methodology section. displaying the methods we use to collect our data. And so for temperature, both water and air temperature, we typically used a Vernier temperature probe, and we put in a hobo temperature and light logger from October 3rd to December 3rd, but unfortunately the water that they were in leaked, and so the data was corrupted and unretrievable. This is our flow rate meter, a Vernier probe, and we used it to measure flow rate for every year. Here's our conductivity meter, and so that's another Vernier probe, and we had it on the 0 to 200 microsiemens setting. For pH, we typically used a Vernier probe, but occasionally that was not functional, and so when that probe was down, we used an EcoTestR pH2 handheld probe. For turbidity, and turbidity is a measure of clarity of the water, we used a Vernier sensor. And so we calibrated it first with deionized water at 0.0 NTUs, and then a standard, which was 100.0 NTUs. After calibration, the sample is inserted, and the sensor plots that value based on the linear relation of the calibration values. And so for dissolved oxygen measurements, we used a Winkler DO kit. And so that involves a titration. So the first step is adding manganese sulfate and potassium iodide, potassium alkaline iodide azide. And then an equal amount of sulfuric acid is added to fix the sample and dissolve the newly formed precipitate. And then after that, the acid formed is titrated with sodium thiosulfate. And about halfway through that titration, starch indicator is added so that that titration can be completed. And when the solution reaches neutral, the amount of sodium thiosulfate used is recorded as dissolved oxygen in parts per million. And we used a handheld refractometer to measure salinity of the water. So how that works is you calibrate it with deionized water to 0 PSUs. And then a sample is loaded in. And so light comes in through this blue prism here, and it's distorted based on the salt content, and so that measure of distortion can be observed on the other end of the eyepiece. And for total phosphorus, we used a treated vial and refrigerated that sample and then sent it to UMaine to be analyzed in a spectrophotometer. As for bacteria presence, we only sampled 3 times total in the year, and then 3 samples, one for each site. And it was a qualitative sample that used a Colliler standard, and so that simply determines the presence or absence of coliform bacteria. For macroinvertebrates, we use rock baskets. And that's a technique for acquiring a macroinvertebrate sample over a length of time. And so what it is pictured at the top right, is it's just a small netted bag filled with rocks from the stream. And so over about 3 weeks, macroinvertebrates will go and live on those rocks. And so at the end of the 3 weeks, you pull out the rock bag and you preserve the macroinvertebrates that are in there. So we put ours in for 28 days, starting on October 3rd. And we took them out of the stream and rinse them off, and then with those bugs, we preserve them in 70% ethanol alcohol. And this technique is a standard Maine DEP assessment technique, and so we followed their protocol as closely as possible. And for our second macroinvertebrate sample, we used a kick net, and so that's a method where it only takes one sample session to gather the macroinvertebrates. And we followed the protocol shown by UMaine at the Smart Summer Institute. And for these samples, we kept them alive at the Hutchison Center, and we observed their behavioral characteristics for 2.5 weeks, starting on May 7th. To identify the macroinvertebrates that we had, we used a dissecting scope and macroinvertebrate keys. And so the dissecting scopes that we used were Unitron dissecting scopes with Nikon objective and ocular lenses. And the University of New Hampshire's key to aquatic invertebrates was primarily the identifying key used.
And we collected data. We collected about 91 total cases from September 28th, 2016, from May 27th, 2017. Now, here we have connectivity over the year for our upstream site. And as you can see in the graph, we have a display during the winter months where there is higher conductivity between January and February. And this suggests that during the winter, when the roads are salted, that salt contaminates the nearby stream.
And the reference lines on the graph here are the optimal stream conductivity for fish. And this is the lower range of conductivity in the U.S. rivers, but it's an average of the U.S. rivers' conductivity.
And for here, we have conductivity over the year at Mill Pond. Now, between the months of January and April, the data rose to its highest peak, and this could have been the result from runoff from the nearby steep banks and also Route 1. Now, this graph is for conductivity over the year downstream. Now, for many of these graphs, they are, these graphs correlate like very similarly. So for downstream and upstream and Mill Pond, they're all have the same results. So from between January 14th and February 23rd, the data was not collected, which you can see with this flat line right here. And during this time, a spike in conductivity could have occurred similar to that of Site 3. However, it's impossible to be certain, and it's just as likely that it could have remained constant.
So the reason the data wasn't collected right at that time is, as I stated earlier, we had to switch access points for our downstream site halfway through the year, and so that caused small issues with our data.
Now, this is pH over the entire year, and as you can see, the pH drops throughout the year, and we can assume that this is because of snow melt that is added up in aquatic systems and is lowering the pH. And this is also displaying our pH over the year for our upstream site, and throughout the year, samples show that the pH levels have decreased over the winter and into the spring from about November to March is where they've decreased. And the graph suggests that snow melt is what caused this drop in pH. Now, pH over the year at Mill Pond. This graph shows a similar correlation to the pH graphs of the downstream sites, like I've mentioned earlier. And it also suggests that snowmelt could have had an effect on the decreasing pH levels in the winter to early spring. And this is pH over the downstream. And it also shows that pH levels decreased through the year because of snowmelt, which is known to be acidic and could have caused pH levels to display more acidity. And this is representing dissolved oxygen over the year at our upstream site. And dissolved oxygen levels increased in the winter months due to colder water having the ability to hold more dissolved gas. And same for at Mill Pond, the dissolved oxygen over the year. This is the same as the previous graph. During the winter months, dissolved oxygen levels increased due to the cold water having the ability to hold more dissolved gas. And for this graph, also displaying dissolved oxygen for downstream site. For the most part, the oxygen levels increased during the winter, except for two cases right here and right here during December. During the month of December, they've dropped to their lowest levels, which is around a pH of a dissolved oxygen level of 7. And this could be because of biological/chemical activity or inherent instrument error.
And so here we have the dissolved oxygen for all the sites graphed together over the year. And right here we have reference lines showing what is considered a healthy range of dissolved oxygen. And so as you can see, most of the points are either in the range or above it, and we've determined that that would still be suitable for fish to live in, as there has to be a very large percentage of oxygen saturated in the water for it to be considered a supersaturated environment where fish would be harmed.
And for this, everything remained constant throughout all of our sites. Also during the colder months of December, where DO for each site declined. This could be because of a biological as well as chemical or instrumental error.
So this is the variability of dissolved oxygen by site. And so we can see that site 2 at Mill Pond, the pond had the largest range of dissolved oxygen values. And that's simply because it's a pond, and so it has a lot more variability in holding the oxygen. And at the top, we have two graphs, both depicting our downstream site, and again, that's due to just technical difficulties in getting the two sets of data into one graph.
Now, the water temperature throughout the year, we displayed that temperature falls in the winter, and in Mill Pond, it stayed constant at a constant zero because of the ice and the ice formation and low flow rate. But the other sites, it can raise slightly throughout the winter. And site 2, as you can see, it's being displayed with this green line that is remaining at a constant. And the rest, you can see, are fluctuating, but still remaining constant.
So this is our section covering the macroinvertebrates that we gathered and analyzed. So to start off, what are macroinvertebrates? They're the larvae of flies that live on the bottom of the stream. And so full name for them is benthic macroinvertebrates, and that benthic comes from the place that they inhabit, the bottom of the stream bed. And so each taxa is adapted to a different habitat. For instance, the mayfly heptagenias. Typically are found in areas of water where there is a very low flow, versus stoneflies tend to inhabit a very high flow habitat. So depending on the taxa that you gathered, you can determine certain qualities about your stream. As well as this, each taxa has certain tolerance values. And so a tolerance value is a number between 0 and 10 that determines how tolerant or intolerant the taxa is to pollution, with 0 being completely intolerant to pollution and 10 being very tolerant to pollution. So analyzing this can give a biological assessment of the stream rather than a chemical assessment, which we just went over. And the site that we gathered our macroinvertebrates from was the upstream site, site 3. And we sampled this using a 28-day rock basket following the DEP protocol. So here's some of the macroinvertebrates that we gathered, and this just shows the range of species that we found. And so we have Helicocycete borealis here, and that's a caddisfly. And then we have another caddisfly, Hydroptilidae hydroptila. And up at the top right, we have an aquatic tick. And this actually didn't come from the preserved samples. This came from our live sampling session. And in the bottom right, we have two midges in the order Chironomidae. So these pictures were all photographed by us using a dissecting scope camera. So here we have a pie chart showing our macroinvertebrates that we collected, and they're organized by order. And so the largest order by far is Trichoptera, or the caddisflies. And that has 163 specimens. The second largest is Ephemeroptera, or the mayflies, with 66. And then we have beetles, the Coleoptera order, at 8, diptera or the true or common flies at 7, and then Plecoptera and Odonata, or stoneflies and dragonflies, both only had 2 specimens. So we made a pie chart of each taxa for the Trichoptera, or for the caddisflies, and unfortunately the names came out in a rather small text, so we relabeled some of the larger slices. Our most dominant species was Leptocerity ocetus at 41.7%. The second most dominant was Hydroptility hydroptilla at 24.5%. And the next largest slice we have is unknown, actually, and it makes up 11% of our samples. The reason it's unknown is because the bugs were either too small to identify or too damaged to identify. So here's a couple slides of the Leptocerids that we had. And so here on the top we can see the actual bug, and underneath we can see its case. And so a few things to note is that it's very small. I believe this is zoomed in almost to the most that we could zoom in on the dissecting scope. And its cases are made of small organic matter that it weaves together to protect itself. Its characteristics that distinguish it are its long legs, long antennae, and its long maxillary palpi. Now, maxillary palpi are 2 sensory organs that are similar to antennae, and they're towards the top of its head. And our pictures just show it inside the case, about half out of the case, and fully out of the case. And we found 68 total Leptocerids in our sample. This is our Hydroptilas, and so we can see it outside of the case and then inside its case. And so their cases aren't like the Leptocerids. Theirs are much more sac-like, and they're made of pebbles and the silk that it weaves. And so once you take it out of the case, you can see that the Hydroptilas have a very enlarged abdomen, and so that's one of their identifying characteristics. And we found 40 of these total in our sample. The next caddisfly we have shows the range of caddisflies. So the previous two both had cases, and this one does not. Instead, it's covered in sclerotized plates that help protect it. And so here we can see the gills, and it has gills here, as the other ones did not, because it has the sclerotized plates covering it. Above that, we see its anal prolide, which is also used in identifying it. And over in the top right, we have its head pictured. And so here is another caddisfly, although it probably doesn't look like one. It's the Helicocycete Helicocycete borealis. And it simply looks like 2 pebbles, but if we switch to the next slide, we can see a similar picture up here, and if we zoom in on this portion of it, then we can see that there is a head inside the case. It shows up dark, but it is there. And now we can see it a bit better. And we see that the head is really, it's coming out of the case. So they are very snail-like, very periwinkle-like, and they make this rounded, it's really a periwinkle shell shape. They make that form of a shell, and so that's very unique because it's the only caddisfly that makes a shell like that. The rest of them are tubular. So then we have the mayflies, and these are the taxa of mayflies that we found. And a very large portion of them were unknown, at 77.3%. And that's because the samples were either too small, too immature, or too damaged to get a reading on, or something unique with the mayflies is that they lost their gills. Their gills simply fell off the body, and you need the gills to identify them, and so they were unidentifiable. So this is mayfly, and it looks like a good specimen. It has mostly all its legs, And yet it's unidentifiable purely because it is missing gills that would normally be on its abdomen. And so a few things that we notice about the mayflies is that they're visually recognizable from caddisflies. They have a longer and a more broad and a flatter body, and their legs are also more broad and flat. And this is just another mayfly that we had, and it just shows how damaged the specimens can get. This is actually one of the better preserved specimens, and yet it's very degraded. And so here we have one that we could identify, the Heptagenidae macfertium. And so we notice that it has very large eyes and a slightly translucent body. And the real defining characteristic in this is that its last set of gills are more slender than its other sets, which are more rounded. And these are the midges that we found, order Chironomidae. And so they're distinguishable from caddisflies in the fact that they don't have legs, whereas caddisflies do. So they have long cylinder-like bodies, and the only sclerotized portion is their head. And the way you identify them is you look under the head on the ventral side, and you see it has a ligula, which is an organ used in feeding. And so that can identify to subfamily, but no further. And so the way we identify it further is by dissolving it in a 10% potassium hydroxide solution for 24 hours. And we can see that right there at that circle, that's the ligula that we use to identify it to subfamily. And after we dissolve it, it becomes very visible, and as well as that, the other characteristics of the skull become visible. And that allows us to make the identification to genus. So here we have a stonefly. This particular one is in the family Pyrrhidae and the genus Acromeria, species Abnormis. And something we notice is that it is not pictured under the dissecting microscope. We took a picture in a petri dish because it was simply too large to take a picture of under the scope. And so it's a very large specimen. Stoneflies molt, and so we actually were able to witness that with our live sample. And they have two claws on each leg, which really distinguish them from mayflies. Just looking at them, they look similar to mayflies, but they have two claws on the end of their leg rather than one. And another characteristic is that they only have two tails, no more, no less. So this is the stonefly pictured under the dissecting microscope. It's very large, but something we can see here is the maxillary palpi. And so those were the identifying characteristic of the caddisfly Leptoceratiocetus. And here is the live sample that we had. That's a stonefly right here. And you can see that its body is white, and its broken body is this cut in half portion there. And that's it in the middle of a molt. So we analyzed our samples, and we did that with a DEP imitation analysis based on one site using rock baskets. From this analysis, we were able to get a stream classification, a biological index, a total richness value, and an EPT richness value. Richness is simply how many taxa you have, and then you can narrow that further with certain taxa of an order. So EPT stands for Ephemeroptera, Plecoptera, Trichoptera, and that's mayfly, stonefly, caddisfly. And so it's the richness of those three flies put together. So, from our analysis, we concluded that the stream was class B, which means it is suitable for drinking water after treatment, it is suitable for fish to spawn, and is suitable for recreational use such as fishing, boating, and swimming. And that classification was based on the various orders' richness, the dominant taxa, Leptoceratiocetus, and the indicator taxa we had, and a taxa ratio. And so dominant taxa is once again simply the most organisms you had of a certain taxa. An indicator taxa is a certain taxa that has determined to be indicative of something. And in our case, we had a Glossosomatidae caddisfly, and that meant that the water was very healthy. The taxa ratio is a way of comparing your mayfly, caddisfly, and stonefly taxa, and that just gives you a number that'll factor into the class calculation. And so for our biological index, we came out with a 4.425. So what a biological index is, it's a numerical scale from 0 to 10, and it's a weighted average of all the specimen's tolerance values. So it gauges how tolerant your organisms are to pollution. And something interesting about the scale is that it's not quite linear. The point where a stream is determined to be non-sustainable is close to 6 or 7. So a larger portion of the scale is focused on healthy streams and their different classifications. Our total richness value, how many taxa we had total, was 20. And our EPT, Ephemeroptera, Plecoptera, Trichoptera richness, was 16. So most of our organisms were stoneflies, mayflies, and caddisflies. Something interesting about that figure is that typically in a rock basket sample, you would see either a much higher total richness or a lower EPT richness, and that's because you would have many more chironomids, or midges, in your sample, and they're of the order Diptera, so they would not factor into this calculation. They would raise this total calculation. We did not have that situation, and we can conclude that that was simply due to our novice abilities in both sampling and sorting.
So our conclusions, we concluded that the data provided by analysis of the macroinvertebrates collected gives reason to believe that the mill stream would be suitable for aquatic organisms such as herring, alewives, and American eels to inhabit if the dam was removed.
So this statement is further supported by the chemical data we gathered over the year. Specifically, the dissolved oxygen, pH, conductivity, and temperature all fall within a reasonable range for aquatic life to live in. And here we have the work cited, which is a combination of the books we use to identify our macroinvertebrates and online sources that we utilized in creating this presentation. And lastly, we want to thank Susan Terrier, John Tipping, Molly Schaffler, Tom King, and Dave Thomas for all their help.
Thanks for watching.